then I remember for me, when I left you, I remember we cried so hard. But later the other day I was reflecting, because that was like 4 years ago now, that actually it was because a separation was taking place, you know. I didn't realize it completely. I don't know whether you did, but a separation was taking place, you know. And I kept thinking, who does that? How to leave your daughter in a foreign country? Are you crazy? You've always protected this child. And so your journey of beginning to become the woman who you are, and what you want, and separating from mom is there. But I want us to talk about that, because I'm strong, you're strong. Sometimes we have very divergent views on things, but you always know that I'm coming from a position of love, even if it's not obvious. But how has it been sort of that disengaging? Because you have to disengage, you know. I'm strong, I want to hold on to you, but at the same time, I have to let you go and let you do your stuff. But it's not been easy, even with us.
I just think it's because you've come from living in your parents' home, your every move is being asked.
Because you
for
call
permission.
Me, you know, you call me CIA at or, the FBI out there. It's very unfair.
Because
am I the FBI really?
Like, you need to send status updates.
Yeah.
Where are you? Where are you coming home? Nah. And then now you get to live on, not even just in another place, another continent, a whole other country, a whole other culture, and different time difference. So someone doesn't know where you are today. So you're just making your own decisions. If you want to leave the house now, you can leave. If you want to do this, you can do it. So at that point, you just have, as a parent, you have to trust that how you've raised your child until this point is enough, and you're letting them go to make their own decisions. So I feel the tension or whatever you're saying comes into play when now maybe I come back home and I'm used to living, leading my life this way in another place, and then when I come back home, I have to now understand, oh, I'm back, I have to ask for this, I have to just for respect purposes. And then you're also trying to figure out your own life. You think things should go this way because that's how you've been doing it. So I think that's just where the tension comes in.
And you know, sometimes I just ask. It's just simple. You don't have to answer on YouTube, but anyway, I always want, you know, we're asking, because like now when you're going out, even if you go out like you're away, I just want to know that you got home, you know. That's all I want to know. I just want to wake up in the morning and see I am home. So when I don't see your home, of course panic sets in, you know. So I'm not the CID. You told me actually I'm the CID. I'm the FBI and the CIA. No, I just want to know where you are and are you okay.
Yeah.
And I told you the other day, it makes sense, you know, like if you're at home even here and I don't know where you are, I usually do tell me where you are anyway, but let's say I wake up and I don't know where you are, and let's say God forbid something happened, it will never happen, but if something happened, surely I'll look like a very bad parent if people are asking me, where is the child? I don't know. Where did she go? I don't know. I mean, I've got to be able to answer some questions and look responsible. I cannot be report something after 4 days. I need to, I mean, how does that make me look? I look like a very irresponsible adult and a human being. So that's the only reason that it seems like I'm policing you, but I'm not policing you. I just want to know where you are you okay, and is everything fine?
Yes.
And it's coming from a position of love. And I think also as young people out there, please understand, your parents are not crazy. They just love you. They just want to love you. Maybe the love is overpowering, but we are just trying to love you and make sure that you're safe and make sure that you're sound.
Yes.
And so strength is good, but I'm also very proud that you're an extremely strong woman out there charting your own path, and I expect great and mighty things from you. And also prayer. You know, the other day, I remember, I think I came to visit you and I was telling you how I can see the effect of prayer. And I feel like I want to say that we prayed for many years, you know. And that's another thing we didn't talk about. We must go back to when we'd be in the house and there'd be no food. And I would always say that you had so much faith. Remember when we, like the first day when we didn't have any food and we left? I think I'd like to share about that. And then you'd always tell me, you know, we'd always come and find a miracle has happened. And then you tell me, Mom, please, can you leave the house because something is going to happen? So it's like it grew your faith. So I'd like to talk about that a bit as I come back to talking about prayer and how I can see the effects of many years of prayer working now. How did you feel that time? Because you had a lot of faith. You had more faith than me. We'd go, we'd leave, there'd be no food in the house, but we'd come back and always there'd be a miracle. Either there'd be food, there'd be money, there'd be something. And we learned to live by that faith.
I feel that dream, when I had it, was so profound, because I was just sleeping. I was not really churchy at that moment, but that dream was, it felt like real life. And so it was just a reassuring message that this is just what is supposed to happen. And then because I would see different ways that God would provide through people, through different avenues, I was like, as a child, if he's done it once, then he's going to continue seeing us through. So I feel it's just that childlike faith that you just believe, because like a child, if you leave a baby here, they are gonna cry, someone's gonna come feed them, because they can't do it for, on their own. Mm. So if God has led you on this path, then you just have to believe it's him or it's no one else. There has to be something that's coming. You have to just take care of us. So that's what I was
feeling. That's how you feel.
Yeah.
And then I was thinking the idea when I came to visit, I was telling you how I can see, I just had a moment like this is a culmination of many years of prayer. And I know sometimes you really are, just like I did, when my mom used to call us for prayer, we used to roll our eyes. I even said, when she'd take us to church, she would enter, we exit. You know, we enter with her, then we exit. So there's always this thing about maybe young people not wanting, maybe their parents' God. I don't know whether that's it, or maybe to pray the way that your parents pray. But you do pray, I know. There's a way that you still engage with God. Yet I was saying, when I went to Leeds, I found a church. You know, until today I don't know where that church is. I should have gone on a tour of Leeds when you went back. But I found a church, and every Sunday morning, I would be in church. And you know, there's nobody in church. So it would be like 10 guys, but without fail, every Sunday morning. So this thing that my mom had instilled in us of going to church and to pray still followed me. You know, when I was an adult, I still went. Even you still would go to church at like Hillsong and places like that. You'd still find a church and still connect, even though you really, these prayers, I know how you roll your eyes, how we spoil your weave when we're anointing your head with oil. But prayer is very important out there. It has helped us. So I want you to, your take on prayer. As I share my take on prayer, you know, it's always so amazing. And you always say, I think my weave. I'm like, my weave? Kneel down. We have to anoint this head. And you know what helps me is how somebody else shared with me how when they would go away, their parents would pray. And it's very effective, you know. Do you remember how I anointed your room, your first hall of residence, everywhere, including the pub, anointing? So prayer works. And all I know is prayer, and it has worked. Doesn't it work? It worked, honestly. We can look at our lives and say that prayer has worked. But just tell me about how you yourself have found your own way to relate with God. You know, not the pastor's way, not the way the world wants you to relate, but how, just because of growing up in that atmosphere of prayer when I was going through ministry, that has made you also a prayerful person in your own way.
Yeah, I think that's the first important thing, that you can exercise your religion or what you believe in your own way. It doesn't have to be for sure. It doesn't have to be the way society says it. So you might not see someone in church every Sunday, but they could have their own personal relationship and the way they relate with their God. So definitely I believe in God. Definitely the prayer that I saw as I was growing up, and the fruits from that prayer that came to pass, showed me that, yeah, this is real. And even the transition of your life, you couldn't have refused to leave your job. You left a big prominent job. You are top, heading a whole department. And you're just like, no, I'm going to live this good life and follow God and do what he wants me to do. And yeah, it's not that it came in one day, but look now, you're doing well. You're successful in whatever you're doing. Not only being a pastor, but you still do training, coaching, and all these other things. So it's a testament, definitely. I have to say that those prayers have led us to where we are today. So why would I not pray in my own life if I can see the fruits of that prayer, the fruits of believing in Christ and all that? So yeah, from the fruits that I've seen today, I see that prayer was necessary.
And you'd still gather yourself and go to church on Sunday.
Yeah.
Which was good, you know, that was good. That was helpful to me. So mothers out there, fathers out there, take the children to church. They enter. If you enter the exit, it's okay. Build this, I think, this traditional culture
church,
of going to church sometimes.
I
guess as you're growing up, but it was good that you were growing up with church.
School and
yes, because Sunday school really helped you.
You can stay home, have a quiet moment.
Yes,
with your Bible,
that one I'm not refusing.
Listen to some Christian Hillsong. And that's your
watch
church.
Watch TD Jakes
Jesus.
On YouTube and pray, and jump things up and down.
Yeah, because some churches are not really the churches.
Yeah.
Of the Bible.
Yeah, don't start. Yeah, the churches of the Bible.
Yeah.
Don't start that story here and a conversation. But it's true. And I think things change, don't they? I mean, there was a time and place for that church. I think the church evolves, just like the world evolves, you know? You know, some people don't like the fact that people don't go to church, but now you can find church on your phone. I mean, church can be on your phone. That's development, you know? That's technology. People are encouraged to go to church, but you can watch church from your house, you know? You can put it on and watch a Sunday sermon. You can connect to any YouTube channel anywhere in the world.
I agree with you. The foundation stages are key.
Yes, because I also want to talk about that. Because I really loved for you, this one I can even say, I remember, I don't know whether you remember, but we'd go to a church. I guess we can't say that one, but we'd go to church. I tried to get you to go to Sunday school and you would refuse. Mm. I take you to Sunday school, 3 minutes, I find you in the main service. And of course, you're not going to understand what's going on. And I was so frustrated. But the one day when we went to Nairobi Chapel, I couldn't get you out of the Sunday school. Yeah. What do you feel like that had an impact on your life, and what was that about?
Yeah, I definitely believe anything when you're building, even a building, the foundation is important. So definitely being founded in Christianity, going to Sunday school, being surrounded by people who are praying, and just that whole Christian element definitely has a role to play in how I lead my life today.
What about, like, remember, like, then went to Mavuno, went to Greenhouse, and then you developed a really amazing relationship with Pastor Angie, because also I think it's important, there are things that Pastor Angie told you that I couldn't have told you. Now Pastor Angie, the other Pastor Angie, but how do you feel about her? Well, you can also speak in the camera, speak to me, she's watching. But yeah, I think that was edifying, I think it would be important. I can't remember, I think you were 13, maybe 10 to maybe 14. It was important to have her in your life because she was a cool pastor. She wasn't like every other pastor, but maybe I should let you talk about that, because I think it had an effect in your life. And also talk about New Dawn, because there's once you told me that New Dawn taught you a lot.
Yeah, Pastor Angie was a good mentor. I feel like everyone at that, like when you're transitioning from becoming
a teenager,
you need someone who you can be open with, someone who can lead you the right way. And she was definitely someone who was there for me at that time in my life in a strong way. New Dawn, yeah, all these things, all these Christian groups and summer camps and stuff, they were good because you'd find people who were like-minded, people who were in your same age group going through the same things, and you're trying to figure out stuff at that time, and then you can build lasting friendships also. So yeah, founding those foundational stages for your child's life
are very, very important. Yeah. So foundation of going to, I think, to Sunday school, to church, maybe at that time, finding a mentor who's like a younger pastor, but who can relate to the kids was very important. And definitely New Dawn was very important, I think, because you met, you were the same age, and you met, I think, every month. Every month you'd meet and talk. And what I think I loved about New Dawn, or that kind of gathering, was that I always felt like if you're five of you, I think, were you five? Five or eight? That somebody will always keep the other one accountable. You know, it's like if you're eight friends, not everybody can be going crazy at the same time. You know, there'll always be a voice of reason who will be able to almost feel like help the other one up, you know, if you're like going off. So I think those kind of gatherings was also important. And there's a time you told me that New Dawn taught you values. It really, really did. And then you also told me about something about like always being in control of you. If you'd like to share just a bit about that. Why do you say that you always want to be in control of you? Because I think maybe we're having a conversation about, you know, taking maybe substances. I said, why would you never do drugs? Why would you never, you know, get completely, totally high and stuff like that? Because I know that you don't. I know even when people see you, when they go out, that there's always a behavior about Althea that by the grace of God and by the power of the prayers of prostration, hallelujah, I'm going to go. But Why would you? Because then you told me that I was very amazed by your answer. You said that I never want to be not in control.
Yeah. I think first it stems from my personality. I love to be in control and just know what's happening. So even for my own life, I set myself, not goals, but like things I want to achieve. And I would, if I don't, I would beat myself up about it. So I know the lifestyle I need to lead, the way I need to conduct myself in order to get to where I want to be. So I'm not going to let anything hinder me from that, anything take away my ability to get there. So I feel like I always have to be in control. If I'm going out, whatever I'm doing, I need to be careful, because one moment can change your entire life. You can be drunk and then, or even drive, maybe you're not drunk, but there's a drunk driver at the end of the road, hits you, you're paralyzed, you're dead, and then all your plans are gone. So I'm so careful just to know what's happening. And I'm ambitious, I would not say prideful, but I just would not like anyone to see me in a manner that's not Althea. Yeah, I can't have that. So
what is Althea?
I don't know, just someone who is poised, someone who is focused, someone
put together,
knows what's happening. And yeah, I want to look back at my life and see, wow, I've done something. Not for myself, because your purpose is big, and also purpose, because I think you've taught me and the people around you that you're in this world for a reason and you have a purpose to fulfill. Mm. So if I lead my life in a way that I'm not able to fulfill that purpose, mm. so in my deathbed, I'll be very upset. Mm. So I want to be on my deathbed happy, looking back. I fulfilled purpose, I did this, I left a legacy for me and my family. So yeah, it's those values within me and that ambition that I have. Yeah, one thing I say is also ambition. One thing that I've been taught is ambition. Mm. Even when I look at my father's life, mm. my dad didn't come from much. Mm-mm. But he's been able to create mm. a life for me, myself, mm. but even now for himself, that he could never have imagined.
Never.
And I think that's good when your parents are open with you, showing you where they made their money mm. or how they made their money. Mm. Because he came from a village mm. to his child now going to school in London Imagine. And LA and living a good life.
Mm.
It's like skipped a generation has drastically changed just
completely.
Because of ambition.
Yes.
So I feel like that's also, I have that in me also, to mm. just be ambitious. To believe, I have no excuse, because yeah. if my dad has been able to build this from here, mm. then I should have no excuse. I should build times 1 million because I have such an opportunity that he even lacked.
Mm.
So yeah, it's from those people around me that I see. I can't just lose it.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I must ask you about your drive for media and what you want to see media and Africa, because
okay.
you've even just finished your dissertation.
Yeah.
So maybe you could just pick up something from that, because it will help people
yeah.
and what you, how you want people to perceive Africa.
Mm-hmm.